Welcome to SveNFL.
What's up, y'all?
It's Jonathan Rollins.
And Schif Musara.
Two Americans living in Sweden, talking about football. Yeah, man. How you feeling, man? Week 15 is on the way. We're deep in the teens now. The season's almost over. Damn.
It's crazy.
4 weeks and then we're going to the playoffs and it's like, woo. It's already here, man. I'm excited.
Can't wait to start talking about the playoff picture because it's absurd.
Yeah.
I don't think I've I'm not sure I've seen it like this in a while.
No.
We got a little bit of news to get to first. we've sort of hinted around this, but we've never really had a chance to talk about it yet. This whole situation of the leaks coming out of the Jets organization regarding Zach Wilson's willingness or lack of willingness to play was a fascinating story that played out last week. So fascinating that it led Garrett Wilson to come out and speak in defense of Zach Wilson. And it also led to Aaron Rodgers making a face-to-face appearance on the Pat McAfee show.
Oh, Lord.
where, you know, I go hot and cold with Aaron Rodgers, but on this particular case, I think he nailed it. He had some pretty strong things to say about the Jets organization. He said that whoever is leaking this information, it's just a straight up chicken shit move. And he said, this is not the way you behave if you're an organization with a winning culture.
Well, are they?
So
he ain't lie. Are lies detected?
You can think what you want about a guy, and I still feel I have mixed feelings about Aaron Rodgers, but I think he absolutely nailed it on this point. And then, of course, Zach Wilson comes out and embarrasses them further by playing the game of his life.
Shit.
I just thought it was kind of fascinating. And I do not think that this story is done. I still think that there will be repercussions for this. And we don't really know where this information is coming from. And also the way they tried to deal with it, too. Like, you know, the report comes out that Zach Wilson doesn't want to play. And then Robert Saleh immediately has to come out and say, we never said that.
Mm.
Meanwhile, the story is coming out of The Athletic.
Yeah, legitimate.
This is not
a National Enquirer.
This is not some jackass with a blue check mark that he paid for. You know what I mean? Like, this is like The Athletic is owned by the New York Times, for Christ's sakes. These people do not print things unless they turn out to be true.
Right.
And it was double sourced. They had like two separate reporters on the same article who had double sourced the comments.
Ooh-wee.
So the Jets have some explaining to do, in my opinion.
Agreed.
And then they further made the whole organization look just completely retarded. They go back to Zach Wilson for the fifth time. And then a few days later, they released Tim Boyle after his two starts. And then they signed Brett Rypien off of the Seahawks practice squad. I mean, it's just like a continuing pathetic shit show out of the organization in general. It's ridiculous.
Do you think Wilson's on a team next year?
No, I don't.
You think he's on a team next year?
Yes, probably, right?
On some team.
I do. I do think he'll stick around. I think he's shown that he has enough skill to sort of, you know, to hang around in a backup role. No one's going to hire him to be their starting quarterback, but who knows? Maybe they'll maybe he'll wind up in Carolina just to keep some fire on Bryce Young, or I don't know. Like, he could wind up in – there's a lot of places Zach Wilson could wind up.
Were you – I know you took some years off of watching NFL. Were you around for the Jimmy Clausen era?
I was not. No.
You remember Jimmy Clausen?
No, but that's
Notre Dame.
Like a-
Notre Dame quarterback. I hate Notre Dame so much. So whenever they get a quarterback, I just wish them the worst.
Right.
And he sat there at the draft. It was one of those with the draft cameras on him and all of that shit. And he went lower than they expected. The dude with the really slimy face, the draft dude. What's his name? With the glasses and the slimy fucking silky hair. Cause you
is
got
he an NFL, the draft guy?
He's a drafts expert, dude.
Is it Daniel Jeremiah?
No, it's like back in the day too. He still is, but it's all he does. It's Mike Mayock, and then there's the other guy. I forget, man. But he, there was word that he was like paid by his agent, or they had the same agent or some shit. He was really pumping him up to be this guy.
Hmm.
And then Clausen turned out to be shit for the Panthers, and it's like so great. I don't know, and it feels like Zach Wilson reminds me of Clausen, that he'll just go over there and just be shit. And I just wish the worst for David Tepper.
Well,
another
quarterback who's turning out to not be shit, Joe Flacco. The Browns have elevated Joe Flacco to their permanent QB1 spot, seemingly for the rest of the year. They have waived PJ Walker. Yes. So,
but this is what a good, like, I like Stefanski. He was coach of the year a couple years ago, had a little rough go at it last year, you know, and it had a bad luck this year. And he's, I know that they went after Watson. I don't know if that's him. It's probably front office more, but he's made lemonade and he finds the guy, commits to the guy, you know what I mean? And that's what the Jets haven't done. So that's just like two different organizations.
I heard a really funny take from, what's his name? Greg Rosenthal from NFL Network.
Mm-hmm.
He was pointing out how, you know, there are Browns fans who like kind of jokingly have these, they have a, there's a guy, he's got a Browns jersey that has all of the names of the failed quarterbacks that they've had on the back over the years.
Yeah.
And he said, they're going to have to create a new jersey of quarterbacks who have played better than Deshaun Watson since he arrived. I was like, oh,
they're
going
to have a quarterback wedding dress.
It's pretty funny.
With the tail going behind with all the names on it.
Mm-hmm.
Watson played like shit, man, when he got there.
Mm-hmm.
He had kind of started getting into a rhythm, not going to lie, the last until he got hurt. But I don't know, man. He seems weak-minded. I don't know.
Yeah.
What else?
We have an interesting story. NBC has apparently removed Al Michaels from the NFL playoff coverage, and it appears that this got leaked to the press before they even told Al Michaels, which is kind of fucked up.
Yeah.
That
dude's been around since we were kids.
Al Michaels has been around forever, and the criticism of Al Michaels is that he has kind of, he seems rather disinterested a lot of times when he's calling a game, especially when he's doing Thursday night football, because some of those games are so bad.
And they got Kirk Herbstreit on there. I listened to Bill Simmons. Shout out to him, man. He's like an idol of mine. Bill Simmons, who built that fucking Ringer empire and started as a fucking page two writer for ESPN. That's why he's an idol of mine. He is a big fan of Al Michaels, but he made a joke that Kirk Herbstreit was going to do a Thursday night game and the Ravens were going to play. And he was like, man, it's so cool that Kirk Herbstreit gets to see Lamar Jackson for the first time. They put Al Michaels with this dude. He goes from Chris Collinsworth, one of the most detailed, like, they were a great team together, even though Chris Collinsworth could be annoying with, oh, man, that's the best thing I ever saw, man. But it's still fucking Chris Collinsworth. And then you put him with Kirk Herbstreit, who cares about college. We talked before we got on the mic. We were talking before the episode started about there's people who don't fuck with the NFL who only, like, and it's cool. Yeah. It is what it is. Herbstreit was one of those guys, and now they put him on the team. And every game, if you watch one, he finds a way to refer to their college career.
Of course he does.
Because that's what he knows about the guy. Oh, man, when he was at Louisville, it's like, come on, man. Let's talk about the fucking pro offense he's in. So I get it.
I mean, I can understand how some people are not really into Al Michaels.
He's 70-something years old.
But the dude is a legend. He has presided over some of the most amazing sporting events. I mean, I think he called the World Series when it broke out into a fucking earthquake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is the same guy who probably delivered the most iconic sports commentator moment in the history of sports. This is the guy who called the Miracle on Ice game. This is the guy who brought us Do You Believe in Miracles?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, do you believe in miracles? Yes! I mean, I'm sorry, but from Al Michaels' perspective, like, after calling something like that, I think you got to give him a little slack when he has to do a Thursday night game between the Jaguars and the Raiders or some shit, you know?
And you do, and you let him know before you leak it.
Yeah. Apparently he found out. He found out from the reporter who asked him the question, which I think is kind of a dick.
Damn, that's disrespectful to a legend. Yeah, but also, if you're that age, the only job that you should really be applying for is president of the United States of America.
Exactly,
because that's the only thing where
I'd vote for Al Michaels.
I'd vote for Al Michaels.
I don't know. I've never heard him talk about politics. Something tells me he's on the conservative side.
A rich old white man? What?
Yeah.
Well, I think you finally asked me. I really think those people should be on the other side of a fence.
I've always thought that black people should only speak when they are spoken to.
Not a fan of Mexicans.
To be fair, we do not know what Al Michaels is like. But yeah, it wouldn't surprise me.
Abortion only after marriage.
Only when I need one.
Only for me. Is it my maid? No, I'm sorry.
There's a lot of injuries out there, y'all. And this week is the beginning of the fantasy football playoffs.
Mm.
It's slim pickings on the waiver wire for those of you who are still in the fantasy realm with us. I have captured the number one spot, so I've got a bye in week one. I wish that meant that my players don't play so that they would be fresh, but it doesn't work that way.
You let Tyreek rest a little bit.
Yeah, I'm kind of hoping they rest him. Anyway, but yeah, so that's interesting. We're actually kind of in the dark with a lot of these injuries at the moment. We don't know about Tyreek's situation. We don't really know about Justin Jefferson's situation. Who else? There were some other big ones. Josh Jacobs came out of that game with a knee injury. Mm. Herbert's done for the year with a broken finger.
Yeah.
You
think that saved Brandon Staley's job?
No. If he does not get fired at the end of the year, that organization does not know what they're doing. I don't think it should matter.
Yeah, he's done. He should be done. He will be done.
He's got to be gone. So we'll see, you guys. I don't know. We got to keep an eye on this injury stuff coming up. Probably the most fascinating story that came out this week happened off the field. And you and I were texting about this. This was the Jacksonville Jaguars has an employee who has just recently pled guilty after allegedly stealing, like, what was it? Like
$22 million, something like that?
$22 million from the team. This is a very, very fascinating story. There's a long article about it on The Athletic, but it's also in other places where you can find it.
Mm-hmm.
This guy, he was a mid-level employee who worked for the Jaguars from 2018 to 2023. He allegedly created fraudulent charges on the club's virtual credit card system and then covered
virtual
his tracks.
Credit cards.
Yeah, and then covered his tracks by sending falsified files to the team's accounting department. He used it to fund his gambling addiction.
Amit Patel is his name.
Yeah, as well as like luxury travel.
He bought a Tesla, a Nissan pickup truck, cryptocurrency. Yeah. Of course, you got to buy cryptocurrency.
Of course,
and
you
a
do.
Property in Ponte Vedra Beach, Florida. I don't know what part of Florida, but I'm guessing it's on the West Coast. And he bought a Patek Philip Nautilus watch worth over $95,000.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
It's crazy.
I can't wait for the Netflix documentary about this.
It's going to be interesting. And one of the lines in here is kind of the fact makes the question people around the league were asking last week more salient. Like, how could he get away with this? How was Patel working alone able to steal more than twice the amount that quarterback Trevor Lawrence counts against the Jaguars salary cap?
It shows how much money they're making, though, these teams.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, yeah. If you're thinking of hot dog sales, like, mm-hmm. I don't know how to figure it out, but hot dog sales or beer sales mm-hmm. for each home game, it's probably $100 million in a year.
Yeah.
And that's just beer sales.
So the gist of the article, which I can summarize quite quickly, is that there's two sides to every football franchise. The side that has to do with the football-related stuff, specifically the salary cap and all that stuff, is like constantly under a microscope from the league office, the NFL league office. So mm-hmm. every penny is accounted for to make sure of that. However, on the non-football side, it's up to the organization itself. And what happened was that the accounting department for the Jacksonville Jaguars was severely understaffed. And over a period of time, this one individual found himself in charge of like three different jobs in the accounting department, which made it possible for him to steal and cover and lie for like 3 or 4 years. So that's how he was able to get away with it.
Damn. I just did some quick math. If 50,000 people were, because that's like not everybody buys a beer. Their beers are $9.50 per beer.
Oh, damn.
So 50,000 people bought a beer, one beer, which is probably not going to happen. If they sold 50,000 beers at a game and they have 8 home games. I didn't think about London, but there's that. Then beers alone, that's $4.5 million if they only sell 50,000 beers a game. That's just beer sales. No pizza, hot dogs, popcorn, all the shit you could buy at games. That's easily making a bunch of money.
The story behind this guy is kind of fascinating, and we only know just a little bit at this point. I mean, apparently also one of the reasons why he was able to get away with it is because he was described by employees as being super basic. He didn't wear fancy clothes.
Yeah.
He didn't flash his new expensive watch or brag about trips that he took on private jets with friends. One employee was quoted as saying, aside from the fact that he drove a Tesla, if you were to see this guy, you wouldn't assume like, oh, here's a dude that is siphoning millions of dollars from his job. But yeah, it eventually caught up with him. And now he is expected to plead guilty. He's not even going to challenge it.
Can we – so that means he hit some money. Can we can we play a quick game? I didn't plan on this. And I know I was trying to keep the episode short, but I feel like we have to play a game of name that Netflix documentary. Because his name is Amit Patel. And there's got to be a way to name a Netflix documentary about this. I'm thinking Patel Me a Story about, or maybe
Amit and Tell.
Exactly. Amit and Tell. Yep, you got that. Amit and Tell. Don't omit the fact that you stole.
Right. A lie of omission.
There's so much stuff, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was just thinking about that. There's something there, man. We can spitball it a little bit. That's a crazy story, man.
It is a great story. And I think I agree with you. I think there's a Netflix documentary pending. Not officially, but yeah, it's coming. It's going to be fascinating. Yeah. Let's move on to the standings. Right. Before we go do the deep dive, I just want to sort of create a little context here.
Okay.
The AFC has 11 teams with a winning record, while the NFC has 11 teams with a losing record. The AFC has 6 teams with a 7-6 record battling for those final wild card spots. The NFC has five teams with a 6-7 record, plus the Giants and the Bears, who are 5-8, all battling for this final playoff spot. I mean, but I don't know if I've ever really seen anything quite like this before.
I have not. I don't remember if I have. You know what I mean? No. This is crazy.
I mean, let's start on the AFC side.
Okay. Yeah, AFC seems.
We got Baltimore in the lead.
Yeah.
10-3. Miami, 9-4.
Wait, Miami needs to tear it all down. They need to throw it away, man. They're just so bad. I don't know. They need to get rid of the coach. They need to get rid of the owner. They need to get rid of the logo.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Delete Twitter. Just delete it.
I'm off.
Kansas City Chiefs are 8-5, but they're only one game because of their, you know, inconsistency, and also because the Broncos have just been on an absolute heater. They're only one game ahead of the Denver Broncos.
Yep,
who are 7-6.
Watch their six.
Jaguars really missed a huge opportunity to kind of separate. Luckily for them, the Texans also lost this week. But they're only one game ahead of the Texans. I don't have a lot of faith in the Texans at this point, given their injury situation they have going on. Cleveland continues to just, like, I just keep waiting for Cleveland to fall off a cliff, but they just don't.
Yeah, Stefanski, real dumb.
The defense, and then Stefanski being able to coach up these quarterbacks and getting Deshaun Watson out of the way. You know, you got Pittsburgh at 7-6, Indianapolis at 7-6, Houston at 7-6, Denver at 7-6, Cincinnati at 7-6, Buffalo at 7-6. It's like I don't really know who's going to get. What do you think Pittsburgh and Indianapolis will retain the 6-7 spot? What do you think,
man? I think the next Denver Buffalo maybe. It's probably going to be Denver Buffalo. I hope not Buffalo, but I mean, it just looks like it's got like Indianapolis has a better chance than Pittsburgh maybe. But wouldn't it be more fun if Denver and Buffalo are in? They're trending up.
I agree with you. It feels like the teams that are trending in the right direction are the teams that you would want to see in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Because you're just hopefully going to get a better product, really.
Yeah. Cincinnati's it's a fun story and all. But do you want to see Browning or do you want to see Josh Allen? Like us as fans. The teams don't want to see these motherfuckers. They don't want to see Josh Allen. Like I said in the last episode, Josh Allen is that Bills team is probably scarier than a Cincinnati team. Mm-hmm. Maybe not. I don't know. I mean, you are what your record says you are. They're 7-6. I don't know. We'll see. But yeah, it's probably going to be not Pittsburgh and Indianapolis. You're right.
I don't know. I mean, Buffalo definitely. I don't know what they play Dallas next, so that doesn't help. I mean, this could all end.
Yeah, it's gonna be.
This could all end on Sunday if the Cowboys come out and just thump them, which they easily could.
I think 8 losses and you're out on the AFC. I think it's gonna have to be a 10-7 team to make the playoff. Like, you can't have 8 losses. And they'll be at 7, and then they're going to really be back to the wall and hoping for help.
Buffalo plays the Cowboys this week, and then they play the Chargers, the Patriots, and the Dolphins. So
Patriots
it's not super easy.
Nah. Chargers, they're probably – I can't see the state of that team. And the Patriots, and like I said, the Dolphins might be in, they might have secured their playoff position and be resting, especially, they might be maybe trying to get Tyreek his thing, if he hasn't gotten it.
Yeah. I mean, I think the Bills are fully capable of beating the Chargers and the Patriots, but I mean, let's be honest, like, they losing to Dallas this weekend, I mean, that could be the end right there.
Yeah, well, this will tell us a lot.
Cincinnati, on the other hand, they play the Vikings this week, and then they have the Steelers, the Chiefs, and the Browns. So also not an easy ride.
Mm-mm.
And the Browns are probably going to have to be playing for their playoff lives all the way to the final week of the season, I would imagine.
Yeah.
So
Denver's got it rough, too. They got Detroit right away.
Yeah.
Who's got something to lose? You know what I mean?
They've got Detroit, and then they play the Patriots, the Chargers, and the Raiders. So they probably have the easiest path, I would say.
Yeah.
Yep.
Patriots, Chargers, Raiders. Yeah. Tricky. Oh man, maybe. Maybe it's them. Denver's gonna be in.
It's gonna
Denver's
be
gonna fucking be in. And the Chiefs better watch out. Denver might run the table.
I mean, yeah, absolutely. Could happen. If the playoffs ended today, the Ravens would have the first round bye.
Mm-hmm.
Colts would play the Dolphins, Steelers would play the Chiefs, and the Browns would play the Jaguars. But like we said, I don't think that's the way it's going to end.
Nah.
Looks like
it would be a fun playoffs, though. But we need a little more spice in there, man. The Chiefs would be walking. I wouldn't like that.
Just for the sake of the chaos, I would love to see the Bills make it into the playoffs.
I'd like the Bills and Denver to make it in. That'd be more fun, man. But then it might be Bills-Dolphins again, if they're 7.
Mm.
Then it'll be Broncos-Chiefs. That'll be two division games, divisional rivals playing in the wild card.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be cool. And then Browns-Jags.
All right, on the NFC side, San Francisco holds the number one seed at 10-3.
And probably will.
Cowboys are in second, also 10-3.
And probably will.
Lions are 9-4 in third. Buccaneers 6-7. Someone has to win the NFC South. You know what I mean? It's I don't even know what to say about that. Eagles are in fifth place. Vikings are in sixth. Packers are in seventh.
Yeah.
So a situation over here is we have Packers are 6-7. Rams are 6-7. Seahawks are 6-7. Falcons are 6-7. Saints are 6-7. And then again, like I said, Giants and the Bears are 5-8 and definitely not out of it.
All right.
And
Tommy DeVito's, they might run the table with this guy.
In this division, let's Costanza that. In this conference, we're really just talking about the last two spots here because Philly is at 10-3. None of these teams are going to catch them.
No.
So we're talking about can Minnesota and Green Bay hang on to these final two playoff spots? I say no.
Minnesota could possibly win the division, which gives them the three spot. If the Lions fall apart, Minnesota could take the division.
But they're going to roll with Nick Mullins for the rest of the year, right? Isn't that what I said?
Yeah, they're going to roll with Nick Mullins. That's an upgrade.
I don't know, man. I don't know. Alexander Mattison, their running back, he was another injury that came up this week. Not really sure about him. I don't know, man.
They play Cincinnati, Detroit, Green Bay, Detroit. That's tough. Is it tough?
Say
Detroit,
it again.
Cincinnati.
Yep.
Detroit.
Yep.
Green Bay.
Mm.
Detroit. I mean, they're all teams that are middle of the pack, man. Yeah, they could.
I mean, if they win those games, it certainly helps that those are all division games. That could really, really help their.
Except for Cincinnati.
As far as the tiebreaker, you know what I mean?
Detroit twice. If they win both of those games. Then they win a division.
Mm.
It gives them the two losses they need and the tiebreaker.
It certainly bodes well. The opportunity is there. For the Packers, they play the Bucks this week. And then they play the Panthers, the Vikings, and the Bears.
Guess what Detroit's got? They play Denver. Minnesota, Dallas, Minnesota.
Oh, they're going to have to earn that.
Exactly.
They're going to have to earn that. I'm kind of curious if the Rams can sneak in because they have been playing really, really well lately.
That would be fun.
They have a pretty favorable schedule to end the season. They play the Commanders this weekend, and then they play the Saints, the Giants, and then, of course, they play the 49ers, who might not have anything to play for.
Probably
in
won't.
The final. So the Rams have a pretty good shot to sneak in here.
Yeah.
I don't really believe in the Seahawks and their ability to sneak into the playoffs.
Nah.
Geno is.
Yeah. The Rams lost to Baltimore. Maybe Geno was huge, man. That was huge.
Yeah. And then, of course, the Falcons and the Saints, who I mentioned, are also 6-7. I mean, their only chance of making it in my opinion, is to win their division. There's no way. There's no fucking way the two teams from the NFC South are making the playoffs. That would be absurd. But it's tight, y'all. It's a fun time of the year. If the season ended today, the 49ers would have the first round bye. The Packers would play the Cowboys. The Vikings would play the Lions. And the Eagles would play the Buccaneers.
Yeah, it's tighter than Mermaid Snatch.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know that Mermaid Snatch was historically tight.
That's what Sailor told me, the sailor I know.
I suddenly feel the urge to fuck a mermaid.
You heard the joke? You heard the street joke about the mermaid?
Mm-mm.
There's a guy at a bar, and he looks down the bar. He sees a guy with a head the size of a cue ball.
Mm.
And he's like, hey, man, I got to ask. You know, I've been drinking and get a little drunk. I got to ask you, man, why is your head the size of a cue ball? And he says, well, I was in the Navy. And then I got in shipwreck, and then I ended up on this mermaid, saved my life. Took me to the shore, saved my life. And she said, I'm a magic mermaid, and I've saved your life. And because I'm a magic mermaid, you get 3 wishes. And then he said, okay, first wish, I want to get back home to my friends. Second wish, I'd like to be rich. And for my third wish, well, I've never had sex with a mermaid before, so I like that. And she said, well, mermaids can't have sex. And he said, well, how about a little head?
Whoops.
And that's how he got a head the size of a cue ball.
You know what I mean?
That's like my favorite street joke, man.
Words matter, man. You know, you got to be real careful with the words that you choose.
That's like my favorite street joke, man.
That's funny.
Words matter.
Words matter.
Words matter. Yeah. So that's the playoff picture. Let's take a break and we'll come back and do flip and pick 'em and then get out of here. We're back, and that break was brought to you by Brisket and Friends. Brisket and Friends, best barbecue in Stockholm. We got to make ourselves a trip back there, Skiff. So,
you know, I was just thinking that we should do like a pre-Christmas barbecue run.
Oh, let's do it, man. If you do go, Brisket and Friends, make sure to ask for the SveNFL table breaker. Confuse the shit out of them. And it's the best barbecue in Stockholm. So check it out. And barbecue so good, make your mama slap your grandma. Brisket and Friends. All right. it's time for me to call it, right?
No, it's time for you to flip it.
I'm flipping. Yes, I do have it right here written in my digital spreadsheet.
As usual, I'm way ahead of you on the analog.
Jonathan flips. I just wasn't looking at it. All right. So I'm flipping. You're calling it. Let's go.
I'm calling.
I want you to flip it. I want you to flip it hard, like a hard flip. Since you're actually, a hard one. Yeah,
hard
I call it.
Okay. I'm calling, I'm going to call heads.
All right.
Damn it.
That's tails. It's tails. Tails never fails. You made the same mistake that the Rams made in the overtime game. And I heard the announcer say, doesn't he know tails never fails? I was laughing. I thought about you. All right, so I'm starting. Chargers.
Or are you starting? Do you want to start or do you want to defer? It's up to you.
Yeah, I'm going to start.
Okay.
I had to make sure that the that you take that fucking Bills Cowboys game. All right, stay away from that shit. I'm gonna pick the why'd I start with this? Oof, Raiders versus the Chargers. I think the Raiders are gonna win this because, let's face it, Justin Herbert is the only reason that Brandon Staley still has a job, and he's out. So it's gonna get bad.
You don't believe in Easton Stick?
No. I don't believe in. I think porn stars need to stay in porn, and football players need to stay in football. That's the way I see it.
Okie doke. Let's see here. All right. Yeah, that was our Thursday night game. Next up, we have three Saturday night games this week, y'all. The first Saturday night game will be Vikings at Bengals. Mm-hmm. I'm going to roll with Jake Browning on this one we thought he was going to have the comeback fucking,
all cover zeros are not created equal.
And this motherfucker is out here balling. Oh, that's true. Shit. The Vikings defense. Oof. You know what? Fuck it. Don't overthink it. I'm just going to go Bengals.
Can you check back on the asterisk from last week? Asterisks?
There were. I picked the Ravens to beat the Rams, and said, I just want to say that I think.
Did you get an asterisk?
And you were fucking wrong.
You didn't have one?
I didn't have one. I agreed with you fully last week.
Okay.
To be fair, you were almost right. I mean, it went to overtime, obviously.
It was a block in the back call away for me being right.
Yeah. That game is on. Okay. Vikings-Bengals is at 7 o'clock our time Saturday night.
I don't have any comedy. So great. So I'll be watching that live. All right, Steelers at Colts. Oof, another tough one. Why'd I do this to myself? I'm going to say I got to go with I want to say it's a Tomlin pick. I can't pick with my heart. Colts are going to win. I wouldn't be surprised if the Steelers win, but I just can't fuck with Trubisky, bro.
Yeah, he's bad.
I saw. They can't hide him.
That game starts at 10:30.
And they're 6-7 seeds now, right? This is huge.
Yeah, it is pretty big, actually. Yeah.
If I were the teams that are below 7th, I would root for the Steelers because you feel like they'll fall apart anyway.
Good point. Yeah.
All right. What you got?
Next up, this will be the late game on Saturday. Broncos versus Lions. This is a hell of a matchup. I don't know. I'm calling for a big Lions bounce back game. They're playing in Detroit. Mm-hmm. They're gonna be in the dome. Mm-hmm. I think they're gonna figure it out. Yeah. And the Lions are gonna win this football game.
Good point. Bears Browns. You know what? If the Broncos win that game, if you love chaos, you're rooting for the Broncos to win that.
Mm-hmm.
It'll push the Broncos up, and it'll push the Lions down in the NFC. This is like the scheduling gods.
And the Chiefs will be sweating.
Yeah. The scheduling gods, man, they really set it up here.
Mm-hmm.
Bears are playing the Browns. Man, it's not your uncle's Bears here. I feel like they've woken up. They've tapped into something with Justin Fields, but
a little bit.
And the Browns defense isn't as vaunted as I thought. Why did I pick these games? I'm going to go with the AFC versus NFC. I got to go to AFC. I got to go with the Browns.
I think you're right. I think the Browns secondary
Mm-hmm.
We'll have Justin Fields confused all night long.
Yeah, but he stays. Yeah, he's always.
Okay, next up, we have the Buccaneers versus the Packers.
What?
Is that right?
The Falcons-Panthers?
Oh, sorry. I'm looking at the wrong thing. Where are we? Yes, sorry. Falcons versus the Panthers. Why am I picking this game? despite the darkness that has descended upon me as a Falcons fan. Friend. Yeah, exactly. I'm going to pick the Falcons.
Yeah, of course. All right. And the game you tried to steal, the Bucs are playing the Packers.
Yeah, sorry.
To help you out, I'm going to go with the Packers, man. They're going to beat the Bucs, and then it'll put the Falcons back ahead of the division for you.
You're God, welcome. I hope you're right.
Yeah.
I hope you're right.
Yeah. Even though Jordan Love against Todd Bowles, man. Todd Bowles defense.
Next up, we have the Houston Texans versus the Tennessee Titans. I really do think that the Texans are in trouble. I think their injury situation is real. I think they're kind of struggling to hold on to the success that their season has been. And I think the Titans are kind of flying high after this big upset win against the Dolphins. So I am going to actually pick the Titans this week.
Yeah. Shout out to Will Levis growing up in front of us.
Mm-hmm.
And Vrabel putting him out there.
Yep.
He's doing what your boys didn't do last year. Well, Arthur mm-hmm. Smith. Arthur mm-hmm. Smith, former staff member, didn't do. So he learned from his old protege.
Absolutely.
Dolphins versus Jets, not much to say here, except for the fact that the team had its own meeting without any coaches there. Makes me think they're coming out. They're going to punch the Jets in the goddamn mouth, and they're going to win.
Yeah.
No December collapse here.
Next up.
Giants.
We got Giants at Saints. Now, I don't know how long this Tommy DeVito hype train is going to roll on, but it's been kind of fun to watch.
Mm-hmm.
And the Saints have been rather dysfunctional on offense for several weeks now. They are currently favored to win this game by 6 points. I think I'm going to roll with Tommy DeVito and call the upset. I think the Giants are going to win this football game.
Upset alert. All right. I wish I would have picked that myself. It's a smart upset call.
Mm.
Speaking of upset, the Chiefs are playing the Patriots.
Stop it.
In New England, one of the last home field advantages out there. No, I think the Chiefs are going to win. And I think the referees are going to come in ready to make the right calls. They're going to be on their toes.
What's the spread in this game? Chiefs are favored by 9.5.
I was going to say 9. Oh, my God. I feel so good when I can call this.
Over under is 37.5.
It'll probably stay under.
That's funny.
Two really good defenses. Bet the under, y'all.
Let's see. Next up, we got the Washington Commanders.
Still first window on Sunday, right?
No. That can't
because it's in LA. Okay.
Correct. This will be the first game in the bourbon slate. Commanders are traveling to Los Angeles to play the Rams.
Okay.
I think the Rams are looking pretty good right now.
Yo, Chiefs Patriots was flexed out too. That was supposed to be a Sunday night game.
That's true. That's true.
About that. Yeah.
The Patriots are so bad they got flexed. The Chiefs got flexed out. That's crazy. No mystery here. I think the Rams are going to beat the snot out of the Commanders.
Yeah, this will show you. This will show a lot. If the Rams lose this game, then yeah, it wasn't meant to be. 49ers Cardinals division rivalry.
Upset alert.
I think the 49ers, who don't need a tune-up game, are using this one as one. And McCaffrey touchdown bet is in the works. But Jonathan Gannon is going to have his boys ready. I like him.
49ers are favored by 13.5.
Again, 2 weeks in a row, 13.5 point favorites. Mm-hmm. And they did not make it last week. Mm-mm. To our chagrin.
Next up, we have what could easily be described as the game of the week. We have the Dallas Cowboys playing in Buffalo.
Mm. Best fans in the league.
So, I don't know. I mean, obviously, I expect the Cowboys to win this game, but I don't know, man. Don't fuck around. What? Yeah. What?
Buffalo favored?
Buffalo is favored by 2.5. You have got to be kidding me.
That's stupid.
Wow. I'm not going to be stupid here. I'm going Cowboy.
Buffalo about to take this L. I think it's because Cowboys had an easy schedule, but they just beat the Eagles. Handily.
That's crazy, dude.
Handily beat the Eagles in Philly, right?
That is disrespect.
Was it in Philly?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Mm-mm. I don't think so.
I could look it up.
Wow.
No, it was in Dallas. It was in Dallas.
That's shocking.
All right, then we got, that is shocking. The Ravens are playing the Jaguars. What's the spread on this one?
Baltimore by 3.5.
Boo. I think the Jaguars are going to win this game. I'm calling the upset.
Really?
Yeah, it's going to be an upset.
Oh, I'm putting an asterisk on that for sure.
Oh, that's tough. That's tough to do.
I think you are dead wrong.
I think the Ravens snuck away with a victory over the Rams, and the Jaguars are going to come out and win this game. Watch and learn from your boy. Mm. I wish it was a upset bet.
Final game, Monday Night Football. We got us a bird battle.
Oh, I forgot about that. Sounds kind of like it could also be a cat battle. I might need a new bird sound.
That's right. Philadelphia Eagles.
That sounds like a cat with a sore throat.
It does. Philadelphia Eagles are from to Seattle to play the Seahawks. I am going to pick the Philadelphia Eagles, but I'm doing so with the expectation that it's very possible for the Seahawks to swipe this one. I really think it's possible that the Seahawks could upset the Eagles and win this game.
What's the spread?
It's Philly by 4.
Okay. I almost made that my upset of the week when we were talking about it. I was thinking about that. Speaking of, let's get to it, man. Let's get to these superlatives. I want to go sexiest. I could start. The sexiest matchup we're going to start. This one, really. Wrong music. That's like a different type of sexy right there. That's not the sexy we're going for. That's the gambling sexy. This is the sexy we're going for. Oh, yeah. I love your nature. My sexiest matchup for this week. It makes sense, man. Because what does a cowboy do? A cowboy brings in the herd. Brings in the herd, and it moves the cattle around. And in some parts of the world, in some parts of America, a cowboy can bring home motherfucking buffalo, and that just might happen. We get this rough, bearded, tough man with a rope, and a rope can also signify something else in the bedroom. So cowboy whip out his rope and try to bring it to this buffalo that just fought off an Indian, a chief, just last week. So now it's time for them to take on the new boss of the bedroom. A motherfucking cowboy. And it might be back-to-back monumental victories. We'll see. And I don't care how it ends. I'm going to know that it was sexy this week. Bills versus Cowboys.
Mm.
What you got?
I like that. I like that with the rope, too. That's nice.
He's got a rope.
Sexiest game of the week. It's probably Cowboys-Bills. But for me, this week, as I look to keep it sexy through the holiday season, you know I got to go with the bird battle. A bird battle between the Philadelphia Eagles and the Seattle Seahawks. Eagles are wounded, coming off of very sexy back-to-back losses to the Dallas Cowboys and San Francisco 49ers. Maybe not sexy to the Eagles, but ask the Cowboys and the 49ers how they feel about banging the shit out of the same bird only a few days apart. They out here high-fiving, saying, yeah, we hit that. And the Seahawks, who still look a little feisty, despite being on a four-game losing streak, just might be hungry as fuck, staring down the chance to deliver that threesome, y'all. Two birds, both wounded, like quartered animals, forced into the same cage, getting ready to mix it up on Monday Night Football. Don't get much more sexy than that, baby. Eagles, Seahawks, that's my sexiest game of the week, y'all.
That was wonderful, man. That was wonderful. I got to get one final.
Yeah, we hit that.
Shout out to Andreas with that sound idea, man. Oh, my God. We got great listeners. All right. Ken Patera has something to say, man. Who's your Ken Patera upset of the week?
I'm just going to say, go ahead, Panthers. Put me out of my misery. Because I do actually think that the Carolina Panthers are going to beat the Atlanta Falcons. I've been saying for weeks that there is no way that the Panthers are going to win only one game this year. And like an idiot, I've been out here, you know, for weeks calling for them to deliver an upset against teams like the Cowboys or the Titans or the Bucks without looking down at the schedule to see that they have a week 15 matchup with my Atlanta Falcons. Go win this game so that I don't have to pretend like there's hope for us to win the division, only to be crushed in the final week of the season, or even worse, to just be absolutely boat raced in week one of the playoffs. Just go ahead and knock us the fuck out. I think the Panthers are going to beat the Atlanta Falcons.
I am so upset.
Man, that would be rough. Mine is, I called it in our, I meant it in our picks. I think the Jaguars could beat the Ravens, man. I think the Ravens, you could tell by John Harbaugh's reaction. I don't know if you saw it. When it gets right into the camera that's next to him and is like screaming into the camera with elation, was really relief, was that scream. Because they know he knows that he coached poorly. They didn't play up to par. And I think they're not as good as we think as the number one seed. And I think the Jaguars are going to prove that they're better than we think as well. So just for this week, I think the Ravens are going to be saying,
I am so upset.
And for those of you that don't know, that's Ken Patera. Look that clip up, man. It's the best. He's trying to get into character, and he just can't.
I am so upset.
He can't fucking do it. They beat me like a redheaded stepchild. and now we're on to the John Starks bold prediction. I think that we're going to have a Jared DeFrost game. Jared Goff froze up again in the cold. He's just not a cold weather player. He changes and wears gloves. He was known for having little hands, can't grip that cold football. But now he's back at home. He's going to be in the dome. And I think Jared Goff is going to have a DeFrost game, and he's going to throw for 350-plus yards and four tutties in his return to the dome from the cold. And he's going to have everybody saying,
man, did this dude just did this?
In great English. It's John Starks.
My bold prediction, the Kansas City Chiefs will lose the AFC West.
Whoa! Whoa, that's bold as hell.
I think they're going to lose it.
Damn, I got rid of that. That's a bold statement. I used to have that, and it's gone now. But that's a fucking bold statement, bro.
I think they're going to lose it. I think that, you know, this narrative that we had last year, like, oh, the Chiefs can't win the Super Bowl with this shitty receiving core, and they proved us wrong.
I didn't have that narrative, by the way.
And for some, well, it was what a lot of people were saying,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
in the beginning of last season. Mm-hmm. And then at the beginning of this season, it came up again, and everyone was like, well, they won the Super Bowl, like, so. Yep. But this year, it's a problem. Mm-hmm. It's a problem. It's a real problem. And I think that they're trending in the wrong direction. The Broncos are trending in the right direction. And I think it just takes a couple of one or two missteps, and all of a sudden this thing flips on its head.
Mm. Damn. Wow. Our Pigskin Pick'em leader, the leadership has changed hands. Mm. Rasmus was leading for the last couple weeks. And last week he dropped the ball, man. Mm. He fumbled it like Fields in the fourth quarter. And he only got three right. So Nicholas is in the lead. That's about it, man. That's been this episode, nice. Man. Shit, this was great, man. We'll be back to see how right we were, how wrong we were in the reactions episode. But appreciate y'all for listening. As always, another fun episode of SveNFL. Thanks for checking it out. It's been Jonathan Rollins.
Skiff Musara.
With the SveNFL. We'll holla. Peace.
Later, y'all.